Dr. Klumbe? Dr. Tim Zelstra? You're broadcasting on your channel? A new video? This is exciting. Hello everybody. I think it's 3 years since I last updated my channel. I do not really apologize. I've been busy, I've been working, and my job takes up quite a lot of time. And well, now, as you can see from the backdrop, I'm working from home, in my kitchen, in our kitchen, with stuff like oil and chopping boards and all that sort of stuff. Because, well, we're all sort of confined to working from home, at least if we're not in essential jobs we are. And this has been a bit of a system shock to a lot of people. I think I'm fairly well placed to understand what is going on. I've studied the background to this sort of thing quite a lot. I will explain that a bit more, don't worry. But yeah, it's weird. We're all in a weird position and we're all trying to find our feet, dealing with kids around us and partners around us, and you know, or maybe having no one around us and actually being alone and isolated. But the good news is that actually there's quite a lot that is working really well that we need to start acknowledging. And that is why I, as an information scientist, as I like to call myself, am talking to you on this channel, because I think this will be a video of interest. I've asked on my Twitter channel, at @tzelstra. I might put it somewhere when I have a chance. I keep being confused, but it's being mirrored. Never mind. I might put my Twitter handle somewhere down there. But yeah, I've asked if people would find it interesting if I shared my thoughts on what's going on and what that means and how that actually works. And people like that idea. So I think, you know, let's just go with it and see where we end up, basically. I've got a bit of a list. I'm going to be looking down to my left, your right. This mirroring thing is so confusing. But basically, I am going to be talking about the background to working from home. Where does it come from? How old it is, because it's actually a lot older than people realize, the whole theory behind this. And also about why it actually works, because it does work. And let's start to acknowledge that it is working at the moment. Let's hope it keeps working, but at the moment it's working all right. So where does this all start? Well, actually this goes way, 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 way back, all the way, and I sound horrible because I was born in that decade, but all the way to the 70s, in the 1970s. We are literally half a century away from when people start thinking about creating the infrastructure required to have people work co-located or allocated to different locations. And still be able to interact with each other. And that made a lot of sense. You know, this is actually going back even further, because in the army, so this is really old school thinking, if you like, in the army, people realized that you needed to have people communicate between lines and across different sections of the army, different groups. So in World War II, a lot of studies were carried out by the Americans, but also by all the other participants in World War II, that looked at communication and how you could improve communication. So even though we already had things like the telegraph and that, I don't know, telephones, stuff like that, this whole theory accelerated during World War II, and making people more able to communicate more quickly across different planes, ships and things like that. And a guy called Shannon Weaver wrote about this. Is it Shannon Weaver? No, I'm probably confusing all sorts of different people here. A guy called Shannon, was he a guy? A person called Shannon wrote about this in the 40s and said that communication theory was very important. And it was. And then there were some really bright people that worked for a printing company called Xerox. And I don't know if you know Xerox, I think they've sort of disappeared a bit into the background. But they were probably the most advanced when it came to inventing stuff around computers, printers, and that sort of stuff. So they actually invented, for example, the mouse that you all use, or used to use if you use trackpad these days. They invented the way that the QWERTY keyboard looks. That might be one step too far. But they were responsible for having a cursor and a graphical user interface, and sending stuff across to a printer using certain serial cables, and all sorts of inventions that happened at the Xerox Palo Alto Research Center, so the PARC as it's known. And what these people were interested in was actually working from home. That sounds weird, but yeah, actually, that was just what they were looking at. And they were thinking about how they could have people working in their Palo Alto office, communicating with their people over in their New York office, or even in their London office, or the Berlin office, to make sure that information was shared effectively between all these people. At the same time, there was a group of people work for the US Army called DAPA or DAPANET, and they were talking about the network capabilities that you require to send information across efficiently. So there was a lot of development in this whole area. People always seem to think that the internet sort of arised out of nowhere, that when Tim Berners-Lee invented HTML, that was the internet. No, it goes a long, long way back beyond that. So Xerox were looking at how you can effectively work with computers and how you can do stuff, etc., etc. And we all know the history of computers that sort of blew up in the end of 70s, early 80s, last millennium, when people started to buy microcomputers, BBC computers, Acorn computers, all that sort of stuff. Home computing became quite common. I can't call it common, but a lot of people had computers, including we had one at home. I think when I was 8, 9 years old, I was already programming things on a MSX, I believe it was, so a Microsoft computer. And that was a lot of fun. And people were getting used to using computers and actually thinking about what do we do with these things? So we've got them, but what do we do? And actually, I'm very fortunate because my father was one of the first people who was a hobbyist. He was quite keen on computers. And when he discovered that there was something called the Mosaic web browser, which I think was 92, 94 at the latest. He decided he wanted it because he'd already had internet for a while at that point. Haha, see, even before the World Wide Web came out, because he was using, I think they were called Broadcast Bulletin Systems, BBSs. Anyway, he was on mailing lists and things like that, and he was doing that for his hobby. He was talking to people all over the world, just interacting with them via typing messages to each other. And then I discovered, I think, something called IRC, Internet Relay Chat. So 12-year-old me, in a very innocent fashion, went online and talked to people who all claimed to be 12 years old as well. That could have gone slightly wrong, but it didn't. I learned quite a lot from that time. And I've always had an interest in computers. And that's why I call myself an information scientist now, because, well, it's quite a big part of my job these days. So the other thing that they were working on was this concept of paperless office, and we've talked about this for decades and decades, but actually as a underlying force to what is happening now, that concept of a paperless office was really important. So the paperless office is basically stop printing, start working from the screen, start communicating with each other without using paper. And it's taken 40 to 50 years for that to actually be nearly feasible. And I use those words on purpose because it is feasible, but the one thing that they didn't count on was that users quite like paper. In fact, I've got a piece of paper right next to me with my notes on, with my scribbles on. I could have used my iPad. I don't like writing on my iPad. So I still use paper. But we are getting a lot closer to the paperless office. We no longer ever need to print everything and actually do stuff, you know, in the way that we do. So my current job is with the University of Derby, and actually a lot of things were, I suppose, slightly fortuitous because a lot of systems were changed from paper to online in the last few years. I have literally seen that happen in the last 4 years, where things like HR processes, finance processes, they've all switched online. They've all got fancy systems behind them, if you like, where you can actually keep track of the things you need to keep track of by just logging on. And a system like that is called Software as a Service, runs in the cloud. You don't need to install anything. You just log in with your Derby credentials and you get there. And that's actually really important. That's why at the moment we don't have to keep buildings open. We don't actually have to send people in to get certain pieces of paper processed and things like that. And that's why we can actually work from home. What's even more interesting, of course, is that the decision was made. I think it was last week. I don't know. Time seems to be flying at the moment. But the decision was made to switch all teaching online. And in my role as skills manager, library experience and skills manager, I do a lot of teaching and a lot of teaching online as well, and my teams do. So we've been using something called Collaborate Ultra, which is part of Blackboard, for 2 years now, I think. And that works. You know, we knew it worked because a few years ago when it snowed and all the campuses had to close, we switched our drop-in services to online delivery via Collaborate Ultra. And students understood it. They picked it up and they knew that it worked. Again, the underlying message why that isn't the norm is because actually your staff need to be able to do it as well. So at Derby, we're blessed with a very good University of Derby online service called Udol. We do a lot of online teaching, and the expertise is now permeating throughout the organization. And that is something I would like you to remember when I come to how this is going to change our lives at the end of the preamble that I'm still in. So people were looking at paperless offices and working from home for a long time. And then at the late 80s, early 90s, there were a couple of people also at the Palo Alto Research Center called Mark Wiener and John Seeley Brown. And they were looking at something called ubiquitous computing. Forget about the complex word, you know, we don't need to worry about that. Basically what ubiquitous computing is computing everywhere, computing anywhere. And guess what? In the last 10 years, we've been quite lucky with that. Did I pick it up? No, I didn't pick it up. But everybody's got a smartphone. Basically everybody. We did an overview some time ago, and it turns out that 96% of people that we interact with at the university have access to a smartphone. I think that's accurate. I didn't see the actual study, but that feels accurate to me. That means that actually we all have a computer in our pocket, and that means that we can work online as well. These smartphones are incredible, you know, compared to that BBC computer I used in 1980, whatever it was. Yeah, let's not compare the two, because they're not comparable at all. They have a completely different processing power and ability to do things that we couldn't do back then. Even, you know, having your camera and microphone, we didn't have that on a BBC computer. That was unthought of. Why would you have that? I'm sitting here recording this on my MacBook Pro, perfectly adequate to record this and then process it and then put it on YouTube. And that takes a lot of processing power that we now have. So ubiquitous computing is important, because actually what's happening now is the reverse of what they proposed, what their principle was. They wanted people to be able to compute anywhere. So in the last few years, we've had this phenomenon of hipsters working in the Costa with their MacBook Pro, wearing rugby tops and having beards. But let's skip over that. So people were actually taking their work outside, working in different places. And that actually spurred on the development, if you like, of those things that I'm talking about now. But now we're doing the reverse, because actually we are stuck at home. So why would we need ubiquitous computing? Well, the reason is that actually our devices are so much more portable and useful and able than they were before, because of this drive for ubiquitous computing, that we can do things at home with those devices. So this laptop again, I bought it because I wanted it for work and I wanted to be able to edit when I was on the road and stuff like that. And I can do that with this machine. And a lot of people have a device from work, whether it's a laptop or a phone or whatever it is. And that makes it a lot easier to be working from home. So why does this all work? Well, it works because our infrastructure is a lot more mature now than it was ever before. So the internet speeds that we have available to us, certainly in urban areas, are up to streaming video, are up to taking voice calls, even with 10, 15, 20 people at a time. And that is really big. And again, that's something that we take for granted now, but wasn't the norm 10 years ago. Let me put it this way, if COVID had hit in 2005, for example, we would respond very differently to it than we are doing now. You know, a lot of people would actually be out of work because we couldn't work from home. So that is important to realize, that this has made a major difference. I think one point in case, if you like, case in point, I always mix that up. But one example is that we work with our library assistants across the library. So we have about, I don't know, 40, 50 people, and almost all of them are able to work from home and communicate with their line management on a regular basis. And that's really valuable, because that means that we can ask them to do things for us. We can keep them engaged and employed, And it's different, and we acknowledge that it's different, but it does mean that we still have that connection as well, which is important because who knows how long this is going to last. I mean, the libraries could be closed for 2, 3, 4 months. And at that point, you get alienation, you get people disengaged at work, and we don't want that. So we're working very hard to make sure that all our staff are engaged with what we're doing. And also, it's really important for our students because the library closing is inconvenient. You know, we can't actually issue books to our students, they can't reserve books. So we've come up with all sorts of solutions for that to work from home for our students as well, and they can communicate with us in all sorts of new ways. And a lot of my job in the last few weeks, literally weeks, has been to set up a new service that allows students to talk to us via library chat. We are working on improving our online presence all the time, and those are all things that are taking place at the moment and take a lot because, frankly, it's possible, but it's not necessarily easy. It does take a bit of knowledge to get that going. But the infrastructure is mature and works. The other thing that's actually matured a lot is the competence of users. So, like I just mentioned, our library assistants, anybody really, it doesn't matter what age, what background they are, they all have an ability to do things like voice calls on the computer or video calls, like I'm doing almost every hour of the day these days. And that is really important because that means that you can see each other as well. And we are social animals, we like that connection. So, yeah, if you have the opportunity to make a video call, use it. And then the other thing that is actually matured, and I already touched on this in a way, is that software as a service. The fact that our main systems are now available wherever we log in, it's not a problem. We can do what we need to do. So, we have an HR package called MyHub. Means that I can check in staff as being ill or return to work, or I can ask them to do a digital screen equipment test, or you know, we've got all that equipment there, we've got all the infrastructure and software to be able to deliver that, and that's really positive. So I want to talk a bit about the proof of concept because I'm talking about this like it's something that only is possible because we're lucky, right? The last few years, all these developments have taken place. And therefore, we can now work at home. That's not quite right. So, there was a time where what you could call power users were already doing a lot of this stuff. So, even in the 80s and the 90s, we worked co-located or dislocated or whatever you want to call it. So, working in a different office to someone else didn't matter because you could use IRC to chat to each other or MSN or one of the other things that we used back then. And one of the examples I want to raise is I used to be an admin for a game called Tribal Wars. I can't remember when this was, it's a long time ago. It took up a lot of time as well. But Tribal Wars is run by a company called InnoGames, which is a German gaming company. And we had over 1 million users at one point when I was an admin there. And all those people were able to communicate with the admins when they needed to. All the infrastructure existed. And actually, that created a whole community that didn't exist before. So I wasn't just an admin, I was also a player. And I played with people from the States. Don't know why, just because they were pretty good and I liked what they had to do. And I liked their style and the way that they were going about things. So I joined them. And that meant that I've to this day got friends from America that are, you know, just because we were gaming together and we still communicate to each other regularly. So basically, apologies, I'm going to sneeze. I don't think it's COVID, but you never know. Basically, we were all working together anyway, co-located. So the admins for Tribal Wars, we were the European admin team, which meant that we had people from Germany, Austria, Italy, Spain, Greece, Denmark, Sweden, the Netherlands, UK, everywhere, right? And we were all working together in this system that was created for people to work together, and it worked, not a problem. But we didn't have video chat, we didn't have voice chat. It was all done based on text and tickets and emails, etc., etc. So we are social animals, and we don't like being cooped up. Let's be honest, you know, there's nothing more frustrating than actually the weather is pretty great today, but there's nothing more frustrating than sitting at home, seeing the weather being nice, not being allowed to go out for a long walk in the Peak District or go shopping at Meadowhall or whatever you want to do. And that is one of the factors that is going to bounce us back into normality, if you like. And this is where the point of this video sort of comes. I want to make a case for not automatically going back to the way we were before this pandemic struck. And the first case in point, first point in case, I will get that right one day. I don't know. The first example, I don't know why I'm not just saying example. The first crucial example, the first crucial piece of evidence for why we should work more from home is the environment. You've already been aware that the environment isn't going great. You've all heard of Greta Thunberg and the strikes, the school strikes that have been taking place for years now. And they're right. You know, why are we wasting so much of our time and energy, literally energy, oil, diesel, petrol, whatever it is, to travel to see each other when we can do it like this? And one of the things that I think this is proving, even within a week, is that the system works, the system's there. We use Microsoft Teams products, SharePoint, etc., etc. It's all there. It all just is sitting there waiting for us to realize that what these people 50 years ago investigated was right and that we should be working from home more. So I hope, and I sincerely will push for this as well, that we can actually adopt more and better home working models in our practice, in our daily practices as a university, as a community, as a society. Let's just do it. You know, why spend 50 miles of diesel to go to a meeting that you could have like this? I don't know. I genuinely don't know the answer to that. If you do, then let me know, you know. And I'm not saying that there shouldn't be any social contact, social interaction. I'm not saying that everybody can work from home, right? Or even from an office that's nearer to home. That's not the point I'm making. The point I'm making is that where you can, you should consider it. And I think a lot of people will start to embed that as practice, depending on how long this thing is going on. So, yeah, you can work from home and it does work. Let's just accept that. The other thing that I think is really important is that I'm an immigrant or an emigrant or an expat, as the British like to call themselves when they move abroad. I've got family over in the Netherlands still. I've got friends all over Europe, all over the world, really, China, the US, like I mentioned before. And we're already used to communicating to each other like this. So one of the things that this might trigger, and this is sort of futurologists have been talking about this for a long time, and there's been a movement, for example, with high tech companies to make this happen anyway. But why would we have to live where we work, right? So for me, that's slightly less relevant because I have to manage a library. I have to make sure that students can access the library physically. But let's say that I was working as a big data scientist. Why wouldn't I be able to up sticks and move to Scotland, right? I'd love to live in Scotland, go to Scotland, buy a cottage, have a really good internet connection, and work from the cottage. It sounds like a good plan to me. It doesn't have to be Scotland. If you prefer Portugal, go to Portugal. Or if you prefer, like, Devon, go to Devon, or Miami, or Australia, or on a sailboat. There are actually people that work in the IT industry that sail from city to city and upload all their work whenever they dock, and then sail to the next place and then dock and upload the work again. That is something that is possible already, and that is something that we need to consider. We are living packed on top of each other for no real good reason, and actually there's a lot of areas around the world that are becoming what they call what's it called again? I can't remember the exact expression. They're greying out, essentially. So where I grew up in the Netherlands, in the north of Friesland, the villages are emptying. People are leaving the villages because there's no work there. So houses there cost a fraction of what they cost in the big cities. So wouldn't it make sense if we actually get our young people to move to those villages, build a community there again, and work from home? I think it does. Right, these are just some of my thoughts. I will throw this through an editor now and then I will publish it. I hope you thought that was informative. I don't think it was particularly humoristic. Maybe I'll have to do another video soon. Right, I'm Tim, Dr. Klomber, Tim, Dr. Zijlstra, Dr. Tim Zijlstra, whatever you want to call me, doesn't matter. I hope you enjoyed this video and hope maybe that you've learned something. Bye-bye.